Yeah, good afternoon, dear students. Welcome to a session of Advanced Communication Lab. So in this session, we'll be discussing regarding ASK, FSK, and TDM. PSK will be discussing later. So first of all, we should know what are the different digital modulation techniques which are present. So when do we call modulation to be digital? Whenever the data, whatever we are, say the message signal, whatever we want to using which we want to modulate the carrier signal. So that data, if it is digital, then we term that modulation technique as digital modulation. That is what it implies. So we can have, as we have in analog modulation techniques, right? Like AM, FM, then we have PM. So similar kind of modulation techniques are also there, even in digital modulation techniques, in which we have amplitude modulation, phase modulation, frequency modulation. So again, if I go for digital aspect, right, I'll be using something termed as ASK, which is for amplitude shift keying. Then we have frequency, which is related to frequency shift keying. And we have phase, which is related to phase shift keying. So these are the three things we'll be looking out. Then apart from that, time division multiplexing, what we are speaking, it is not actually modulation, it is just multiplexing purpose over there. So we'll be discussing all these things. So let us start off with the first one, that is, what does ASK imply? So remember, ASK, analog form, we had studied amplitude modulation. So in which what happened? The carrier signal's amplitude is modulated based on the message signal. Now the message signal, previously what you used to represent, you used to represent it something as S of t or X of t. So what does this imply? This is continuous signal. So therefore, AM falls under the analog modulation technique, because the message signal what is considered is analog. Now in this case, right, this is the message signal. This part what we are seeing here, right, this is the message signal. So this message signal is digital in its nature. So this, because it is a digital signal, we term it as digital modulation, because we are modulating the carrier. So what are the parameters we'll be able to modulate? Will be able to modulate the amplitude. That is, one is you'll be able to modulate amplitude. Then you'll be able to modulate the frequency. Then you'll be able to modulate the phase. Then in this, again, you can have variations, okay? Like QPSK, DPSK, so just a few examples. So now let us start off with the first one. What is meant by ASK? So in ASK, what happens? It is relevant to amplitude shift keying. Okay. So here, the name itself tells that based on the data, the amplitude of the carrier will be altered. Now here, advantage of digital modulation, what happens is the value is either one or it is zero. So in your, if you go for representation in terms of voltage, right, it may be like, this may be represented with the plus 5 volt, and 0 might be represented with the 0 volt, or it might be a negative voltage, minus 5 volt. So 0 will be this, plus will be this. So here if you just observe, there are only two amplitudes which are present in the signal. Only two amplitudes. So here what happens is, based on this information, what we can do is, if the amplitude is say plus 5 volt, that is if the data is logic 1, if the data is logic 1, then you send the carrier as it is without any changes. That is, you maintain the amplitude of the carrier. That is, this is how it is. The amplitude of the carrier is retained. Whereas in analog signal, if this was the analog signal, that is a message signal, in this carrier, amplitude used to change in this form based on the signal. That is, its amplitude used to alter based on the message signal. Now here also it is altering, but it is constant. Constant for a given bit period. Now here it is logic zero. So since it is logic zero, what we do is we suppress the carrier. That is, amplitude of the carrier is made as zero. So that is what is represented here. So similarly here, it is logic one. So this is 1 bit interval. This is 1 bit interval. So in the given bit interval, the carrier will be present if the data is logic one. If it is zero, carrier is absent. So this is your amplitude shift keying result. Now why it is called as keying? Keying. So here you can see that based on the data, so based on the data, if it is one, carrier is present, that is on. If it is zero, carrier is absent, it is off. So therefore, ASK is also termed as on-off keying. Now, since you are using this as the key to either make the carrier present or absent in the modulated signal, we call it as keying. Therefore, since digital data is utilized for that purpose, therefore we term it as keying. So this is amplitude shift keying. So based on the amplitude, either the carrier's amplitude is retained or it is suppressed. That is, it is made zero based on this data. So this is with respect to ASK. So this is the concept of ASK. So next is the concept of FSK, which is called as frequency shift keying. So in this, what happens? So this is the data, say 1 0 1 0. So this is the data and this is the carrier signal. This is the carrier signal. Now carrier signal frequency will be fixed in this case. Now what happens is, the name itself tells, based on the data, there should be some changes in the frequency of the carrier signal. If it is one, the carrier frequency, say it is retained, or if it is zero, the carrier frequency is reduced. So that is, or lower frequency is presented. So this is how it goes around. Okay. So here, based on that logic, if you just look at the waveform, when it is one, during a given bit interval, what is happening? The carrier frequency is presented. Say this is a higher carrier frequency, which is presented in this bit interval. So this is 1 bit interval. This is 1 bit interval. Okay. Now next, here you can see that it is zero. So when it is zero, it is zero. If you just observe, carrier is not altered, but carrier frequency is changed. Carrier frequency, you can see that it gets reduced. Carrier frequency is lesser than that which is present in this case. So this is what happens in FSK. So when the data is one, say I'll be presenting a high frequency signal, or the carrier signal frequency will be as it is. If it is zero, the frequency will be reduced as compared to your carrier signal. So this is your carrier signal. It will be reduced. So this is how it goes around. Okay. So this is in simple, this thing what we are looking at. So next one comes time division multiplexing. So this is not a modulation technique, it's a multiplexing aspect. So here what happens is, you have one entire channel. On this channel, multiple, say, devices or multiple people want to communicate and utilize that channel. So in that case, how do I go ahead? I make use of multiplexing. So in this one, what is done is, the time slot which is present, so time slot is divided. So if there are 10 users over here, time slot is divided into 1, 2, up to 10 slots. So each slot is assigned to one user. Say this one is for the first user, then second slot for the second user, third slot for the third user, and so on. So each slot will be, the time will be divided. So each one will be given a chance to transmit only during his time interval and not during any other time interval. So in during this time interval, right, only user one can send the data. If he is not having any data, he can just wait. And when it is over, after that, the next person gets the chance. So it is a round robin scheduling kind of thing. So in this case, what happens? first person gets the first chance, second the second, so on up to the nth this thing. So after nth person's chance is over, again it goes back and starts off with the first person. So this is how the multiplexing of the signal will be happening here. That is what is displayed over here. So in order to control these two, we should actually have start of frame, end of frame, then synchronization, all these things. So we are not discussing all those part. So here, data in the first time slot, input one data will be present over here. Next input data two, then next it continues, and next is the eighth. So after this, again, it will start off. A new frame will be there. Again, it will be one, two, three, and so on. He has assumed that there are around eight devices which want to communicate, which want to utilize the channel. So each will be given a fair chance in a one time slot. So this is how it goes around. So during this time slot, nobody else can transmit. Only the input from the third device can be utilized. So in the same way, when this frame or this data is received at the other end, what should happen is this input should go to the first channel output. Then this input should go to the second person. So on, the last one should go to the last person or the last channel. So in order to achieve this, actually there should be a synchronization between the transmitter and the receiver. There should be a synchronization between this side and the other side. So this is the requirement of time division multiplexing. So another example which is present here, you can see that on channel 1, 2, and 3, 4. So let us assume it in this form. You want to multiplex this data. So what is happening is, so one time slot is assigned to each. So first time slot, this person gets a chance. So what happens is, this information will be present in the first time slot. Next, second person will be given a chance. So this is one time slot. This is one time. That is how it is divided. So if you have data, you have to wait for your next chance. So B is there. So next, this thing will be B. Similarly, third person, C is given a chance. C will be there, D. Then after this D, again, you go back and see. You see, you give the chance to the first one. So therefore, again, what happens? It will be A, B, C, D. So this is how the data will be flowing around. So when this data is received, this A, first A should go here, B should go here, C should go here, and D should be here. So again, I get to know that this is the first channel's result. So this should go here and it should continue. So this is how time division multiplexing works around. So this is a theoretical aspect related to TDM, ASK, FSK. Okay. This is the theoretical aspect. I'm not going much in depth. I'm just giving an overview. So now, so before going into the experimental part, right? One PSK is remaining. If time permits, I'll take that up. That also. Yeah, just for time being, we'll try to discuss this one. So here, so before going into this, we can implement these things using discrete components, or we can make use of the kits which are available. So in case of discrete components, right, we can implement ASK, FSK using any switching elements which perform the required operation. So you can use diode, you can use transistors, you can use MOSFETs, or you can use multiplexers. So all these stuffs can be utilized in order to conduct the experiment. Okay. So here, what we'll be doing is we'll be making use of CD4051. So in order to utilize this, first try to understand what are the pin details of this IC. So in this IC, you can see that in this side, it is a 16-pin IC first of all. It's a 16-pin IC. So supply is given here. Then we have ASS and the other details which are present over here. So here, if you just observe, that is, this is the ground, this thing. This one is the plus VCC, what you are giving. So remaining, it's not a problem. So here, major, this thing is the control inputs. So this is actually a multiplexer. This is a MUX and a DMUX IC. It can do both. it is a mux and demux IC. So we can utilize this in order to implement these ASK, FSK, PSK, and TDM. So this is mux demux. So when we speak of mux demux, so what happens? It will be having select lines, S0, S1, S2. This is what we had gone through. So when we utilize these, then you relate it as I0, I1, and so on up to, if three select lines are there, then there are eight possible I/O lines, input lines. If only two control signals are there, then there are 2:2, that is four inputs can be selected. So that is what is happening in so here in this IC we have actually three control inputs. So these are nothing but like S0, S1 and S2. Okay, S0, S1 and S2. So pin number 11 is the LS bit of this control signal, and this one is the MS bit. Okay. This is what is required in this case. So this is MS bit, this is LS bit. So if I just happen to specify, if it is 000, then I0 is selected. If it is 001, then I1 is selected. So here I0, if we just observe, it is related to pin number 13. So here, whatever is present at pin number 13 will be selected. And when it is 000, right? That is when I1 will be selected. That is, whatever data is present or signal is present at pin number 14, that will be selected. Okay. So these two are important for us in coming forth experiments. So if I put on the rest of the inputs can be selected. Okay. So these are the control signals. Like ABC has specified. So we can put it as S0, S1 and S2. Yeah, this part is LS bit, this part is MS bit. And based on this data, right, we'll be either selecting all these input pins. So you can see that these are the input pins. Okay. You have up to from in out 0 to in out 7. So total 8 input and output, this thing is possible. Since it is mux and demux together, therefore it is written as in and out. So these pins are bidirectional. So when it is acting as a mux, right? The I0 and up to say I7, these all act as what? They all act as input. And when it is acting as a demux, in this case, I0 up to I7, they all act as output. So in our case, we'll be requiring the multiplexing operation. Only in TDM, we require the demultiplexing operation. So we'll just have a look at this and see how it works around. So the same, this thing is specified. The pinout details is specified over here. So here you can see that it is the select, it's the channel select which are present over here. That is, it is S0, S1 and S2. So that is what he specifies. This is S0, S1 and S2. And then apart from that, these are the channel I/O pins. Okay. So based on this, we can just check out the pinout details of this for the ASK. So here you can see that. So based on this pin details itself, okay. So pin number 9, 10, and 11. So here you can see that what you have, pin number 9, this is grounded. Pin number 10, this is grounded. Pin number 11 is connected to bitstream. Pin number is connected to bitstream. Now why it is connected to bitstream? So here you can just check out. So here what you have, if it is 1, you present the carrier. If it is 0, you suppress the carrier. So this logic has to be implemented over there. So here what you're doing, so this is always 0, 0. So it is like you have S2, S1 and S0. That is, it is A, B and C. So here what is happening? These two are fixed. Only change will be happening over here. These two are fixed. So if it is 0, what happens? I0 is relevant. If it is 1, I1 is relevant. I0 is connected to which pin? So if you just check over here, I0 is connected to pin number 13 and I1 is connected to pin number 14. So this one is relevant to pin number 13 and this one is relevant to pin number 14. Okay, these are the two pins which it relates to. So now here, if you just observe, so this is a bit stream. It can be either 0 or it can be 1. So, but these two are always 0. So, for example, if these two are 0 and this one is 0, data is 0. So, when data is 0, which pin gets selected? Pin number 13 gets selected. So, what is connected to pin number 13? Pin number 13 is grounded. Pin number 13 is grounded. So, here it is a kind of zero. That is, amplitude of the carrier signal is kind of suppressed. It is kind of suppressed. So therefore, what happens is, based on this 000, I0 pin will be selected, which is actually pin number 13, and that will be presented at the output. So here, what you will be getting, say, since I assumed that data is zero, you will be getting in the given time interval, it will be zero. Nothing will be coming over here. So now, let me assume that in the next time interval, this becomes 1, but this is always 0. So it is like 001. So when it is 001, I1 pin gets selected. The pin is relevant to what? Pin number 14. So pin number 14, what we are connecting, you can see that you are connecting a carrier over here. So whatever the carrier amplitude is there, that comes at pin number 3. So here what happens is, suppose I'll just take a simple thing. It is not actually one cycle. It should be more than one cycle. It is just for simplicity we are drawing it in this form. So here what happened? Initially we got 0 and next we got a carrier signal. That is, amplitude is retained. Amplitude of the carrier is retained because this will be retained at plus 5 volt. It will be retained at only 1 voltage. Therefore, the amplitudes of the carrier is retained over here. So this is how this IC will help you to generate the ASK signal. And the remaining pins, if you just observe, they are left unconnected. So if you leave it unconnected, no need to worry, because your select line will never go to 010 or any other combination except for this combination. Because you have done the connection in that form. Now here, you have to ground the pin number 6, because it is, active low. So we can just check it out. So if I don't connect this, then your IC won't be working over there. So what we do is, even we connect the pin number 6 to ground. And this is the ground of the overall IC. And this pin, we leave it out. We don't connect anything, but we provide the supply to the pin number 16, say up to 5 volt. We can provide. We can go even up to 15 volt, the one which we use in the lab. We can even go up to 15 volt. Okay. So this is how ASK works. Now, with respect to the same, it will be the minor change with respect to FSK. So only change with the FSK will be, you got to know that this is zero always. So this can be zero or one. So if it is zero, which pin is selected? Pin number 13, which is actually relevant to I0. So here what you do is, you actually have to modify the carrier of the, modify the frequency of the signal and apply it here. So this should be a high frequency relevant, and this should be a lower frequency equivalent of this C of T. So actually, the logical this thing aspect is that it is in this form. Okay, so that is the minor change which comes over here. Now, what about demodulation? So here you can see that in input you'll be having a say a ASK signal. Here you'll be having a ASK signal. So now when this is given to ASK signal, this is an envelope detector. This entire thing is an envelope detector. So here what happens is, so here when you apply this input, right, when you apply this input through the diode, the capacitor charges. The capacitor charges up to its peak value. So this point. Now, if the data, depending on what data you had transmitted, based on that, this signal will be appearing. I am assuming here that it is 101, which was the data which was present. So here, what happens is after this, what is happening is the amplitude goes down, but the capacitor tries to discharge through the DRB, so that it can retain its charge for a long time. But since only one cycle is there, what would happen is, so it would charge up to this point and then it would discharge. Here there is no any voltage present here since it is relevant to zero. So what happens is, again up to this point it will be zero, that is capacitor voltage will be zero, but at this point again since there was a logic one, there will be carrier present, so again it charges up to the maximum peak value, and depending on the next data, again it discharges. So what would happen is, charging and discharging would take place. So if the carrier frequency is too high, right, then you can see that what would be happening. That is, if it is too high, capacitor would charge and it would retain its charge for a long time based on the bit period, and then it would discharge, then like this, and then this is how it goes around. So this is what would be happening. Okay, so this is what is happening in this demodulation unit. So whenever carrier signal is presented, there will be a charging through this path through the diode, and if no carrier present, that is whenever data was zero, there will be no carrier, or carrier amplitude will be zero. That time what happens is, this capacitor tries to discharge through this. So it tries to retain, or based on that input, this thing, it tries to retain. So it reaches peak, but after this it reduces, so it tries to retain. But if it is zero, right, there will be no charging and it will be placed at zero itself. So based on next, this thing, the next cycle would be appearing. So your output of this demodulator may be appearing like this. It may be appearing in this form based on the charging and discharging aspects of this, based on the RC values. Charging will be quick enough because diode resistance is very less. Okay. If diode resistance is less, then charging will be quick enough. If resistance is high, it will take a lot of time to charge or discharge. So this is your modulation and demodulation, ASK and ASK modulation and demodulation aspect. So now the same circuit can be slightly modified for FSK. Now what we do is, instead of again giving this to some other circuit and modifying its frequency, what we do is, for simplicity, just to make the analysis, we do in our cases, we put another carrier signal, assuming that both are identical, but only change is, so this is a high frequency relevant and this one is a low frequency relevant. Because for zero, what we do is, we try to transmit low frequency version of the original carrier, and for one, we try to transmit the high frequency version of the original carrier. So this is what we try to do in FSK. So here, based on that logic, when it is 000, this low frequency signal will be selected and that will be presented at the output. Similarly, when this is 001, see, a carrier signal will be taken as it is and it will be presented at the output. So that is what is shown here. So this C1 and C2 are nothing but, we assume that they are the same carrier signals. They are the same carrier signals, but only thing is, this is lower frequency version of this one. So that is what we try to do. So in FSK, how it would appear? It would appear something in one low frequency, one high frequency. That is how it will be. So it may be high frequency for this part based on the data, and then it may be a low frequency for the next part. So again, high frequency might be there, and again, depending on data. So here it is one, here it is zero, here it is one, here it is zero. Again, if next bit is also zero, it will be a low frequency signal. So this would continue. So this is what would happen in case of, so this is what is happening in case of FSK. So here, so again, these are the select lines. So it is 0, 0, 0. If it is 0, I0 is selected. I0 is relevant to pin number 13. So low frequency signal C1 is selected and presented at the output. Now when this one is 1, the high frequency signals at pin number 14 is selected and presented at the output. So here we'll be getting the FSK result. Now if you just hide this part, if you just check out this one, right? This is nothing but ASK demodulator, what you have seen previously. This is the ASK demodulator. If you just look, you have a diode and you have a RC circuit in parallel. So here you have a diode and RC circuit in parallel. So what you're doing over here is, here before giving it to this modulator, you are passing it through a high pass filter. So here, as I specified, this is relevant to your high frequency, this is relevant to your low frequency. So now what I do is, what logic we utilize is, we try to, at the receiving end, we try to suppress the low frequency signal. So we know that high frequency is relevant to one, the other one is relevant to bit zero, that is the in bit zero in the bit stream. So what we do is, we pass it to high pass filter. So I'll be getting here, if the input is, say, something high frequency and then low frequency, what would happen is the input to this at this point, input at this point would be like this. So only the high frequency signal will be present, low frequency will be suppressed. So it may be very light. It will be suppressed because of the high-pass filter, because of the high-pass filter. Okay, so this is nothing but again ASK. So again, your charging discharging comes into play. The capacitor charges through the diode when it is, whenever the carrier is present, it retains its charge till the carrier amplitude is present. Then it tries to discharge if it is absent. If nothing is there, it will be totally discharged and it will be at 0 volt. Again, if some carrier is present based on the data, again it gets charged and it continues. So this is how it appears in FSK. So this is modulation and demodulation. Okay. This is relevant to modulation and demodulation. So next one is time division multiplexing. So here it is almost same to this itself. Here change is, we assume that these signals are continuous signals. And here, what we'll be doing is, since we are dealing with only two-channel multiplexing, we are dealing with multiplexing of two band-limited signals in experiment. So what we do is, we just consider these two. Just consider inputs at these two, and rest all we'll leave it. So what we'll be doing is, again, this is zero, this is zero. This can be either zero or it can be either one. So the C of T is nothing but, it's a very high frequency when you consider at a very high frequency. So it will be appearing as though it will be a square wave itself. So it will be either logic zero or logic one. It will be exceeding that voltage. So here what happens is, so when it is 0, 0, 0, so pin number 13, whatever information is there or whatever message signal is there, that will be selected and presented at the output. Suppose, for example, if I specify that it is something, a triangular wave, it is a triangular wave, and here it is a sine wave. So this one will be divided into time slots. So each time slot will be present. So in a given time slot, this time slot is divided by this signal. the signal which is present over here. So here what happens is, say for the first time slot t1, then t2, again it will be repeating t1, t2, that is ABC what we had seen previously, right, in the same way. So here what would happen is, so based on whether this is 0 or 1, so if it is 0, pin number 13 is selected. So whatever information is there, that will be available at the TDM output. Now next, when it can be 1, so whatever, when it is 1, pin number 13 will be selected, and whatever input is there, that will be presented at the TDM output. So this will be continuing in this. So this is how TDM will be operating. Now what happens is, now we are not dealing with any synchronization and any other stuff over here. So we are just dealing in simple form. What we do is, this TDM signal, whatever is present, right, we give it as the input to this demultiplexer. So now IC, the same IC is being used as a demux. It is used as a demux. So here previously pin number 13 was acting, we gave the input. We can observe that we get the TDM output and we give it as an input to the demultiplexer. Now what we have to do is, actually here this signal will be coming here. This signal will be coming here. So TDM output which is there should be given as input to this IC. So here you can see that pin number 13 was acting as an output pin. Now pin number 13 will be acting as an input pin now. The same IC's pin will be acting as an input pin. So when this is acting as an input pin, what happens is, this acts as a demux. It acts as a demux. Okay. So now, so which data will be given which slot? For example, this is message 1, this is message 2, this is from message 1, this is from message 2. So which one should be given to which? So this one should be going to pin number 13 and this one should be going to pin number 14. So here, this carrier what we have shown should be identical to this one. So there should be a synchronization, but at present we haven't shown any synchronization. So we will just check out how it works out, and when synchronization is required, we'll try to see and implement it. So here, what we do is, this input is given based on this carrier signal. So if it is 0, 0, 0, so which pin is selected? Pin number 13 is selected. So whatever data is there, so in our case it is 1. So that information, that is message from the first channel, or the message from the, here it is 2, right? So message from this channel will be available here. So message from this channel will be available here and given to pin number 13. So make a slight modification. This is as per demux, right? This is M1 and this is M2. So here first message will be given to pin number 13. So here what you are doing is, you are storing that information. You are storing it on a capacitor and you are reading that value. So this should be identical to whatever information you have given. That is all the chunks you will be passing through this channel. So now next, if it is 001, so pin number 14 will be selected, and that will happen during the next time slot, and this data will be made available to the next channel. This is how it continues.